Finally, let me turn to some first passage phenomena of random walks. So as the name suggests, first passage phenomena refers to asking the question, when does a random walker first reach a specified level? And I'd like to illustrate the interesting first passage properties of a one-dimensional random walk in the continuum limit. So let's ask the following two basic questions about a one-dimensional random walk. First one is, what is the probability of eventually, and notice the word eventually sitting here, eventually hitting the origin when starting from X? So X is just some arbitrary point on the one-dimensional line. Let's take it to be positive, and we're asking the question, what is the probability that a random walker that starts at X eventually hits the origin? And second question is, what is the time to hit the origin? Now, we actually know the answers to both these questions from much earlier on in this tutorial, because I showed that in dimensions 2 and below, a random walk is recurrent, and that means that it hits every point infinitely often, and in particular, it means that no matter where I start, I'm guaranteed to hit any point. So if I start at X, I'm guaranteed to hit the origin. Similarly, and this is the part that will be new, which is we can also compute the time that it takes to hit the origin. And even though we're guaranteed to hit the origin, the amazing feature is that it takes an infinite amount of time to hit the origin. So again, I want to emphasize this dichotomy between being sure that you're going to hit a specific point, but it takes infinitely long to get there. So I'd like to derive these two results in the simplest possible way, and for this I will use the continuum approximation. So namely, I'm going to solve the diffusion equation on the positive half line. So I'm going to solve dc by dt is equal to d second c by dx squared. So I'm using the letter c just because it's conventional for concentration. It's the same as p in earlier slides. With the initial condition that c of x at t equals 0 is equal to delta of x minus x naught. So I'm starting at some position x naught on the positive half line. And there's also a boundary condition to make this a well-defined problem, namely c at x equals 0 at any time t is equal to 0. This is known as the absorbing boundary condition. And it basically is stating that when a random walker reaches the origin, the problem is over. Pictorially, we can think of putting an infinite cliff at the origin, and for any random walker that strays into the negative half line, they basically fall off the cliff and die. And so the question of first passage also can be formulated as a question, what is the probability that a random walker survives up to time t? So let us now solve this diffusion equation, and from that, let's answer some of these first passage questions. So to solve this diffusion equation actually turns out to be quite easy, because we can exploit something known as the image method from electrostatics to write down the solution with no work. So if there was no boundary condition at all, we know that the solution for this diffusion equation is the good old Gaussian probability distribution. But because of the absorbing boundary condition, we want to ensure that the concentration is always zero at all times. And the way that we can enforce this is to include an image contribution. Namely, instead of starting with a single particle at x in the positive half line, at x naught in the positive half line, we forget about the boundary condition, we forget about the cliff, and put a positive particle at x naught and a negative particle at minus x naught. And the sum of the Gaussian that spreads out from x naught and the anti-Gaussian that spreads out from minus x naught, clearly these will be zero at x equals zero. And so this image system has the same, satisfies the same boundary condition and the same differential equation as the original problem. Therefore, it is a solution to our problem. So let me write down the solution, cxt is equal to 1 over 4 pi dt square root times the initial Gaussian e to the minus x naught squared divided by 4 dt. And then I have to subtract away the image contribution. So there's a minus sign. And then we have e to the minus x plus x naught squared divided by 4 dt. And so this is a Gaussian, an anti-Gaussian centered at minus x naught, superposed with a Gaussian centered at x naught. And the sum of these two things is, by construction, 0 at x equals 0. So it's a solution to our original problem. And now what I want to compute is the flux of particles that hit the origin. And because of the absorbing boundary condition, whatever hits the origin is then removed. And so the flux at the origin is also the same as the probability that a random walker comes to the origin for the very first time. So this flux, J, is equal to minus d dc by dx. And we want to evaluate this at x equals 0. And so this is equal to d divided by 4 pi dt square root. And now I've got to differentiate with respect to x. So when I differentiate with respect to x, I'll bring down the exponent in the exponential. And so I'm going to have, and because of the minus sign, it cancels the minus sign here. And so when I differentiate, I get 2x minus x naught over 4 dt. So that's x minus x naught divided by 2 dt. And then times the exponential. But I'm evaluating the exponential at x equals 0, in which case I have the same factor, so I'll leave it as a common factor on the outside. And then when I do the second differentiation of the second term, I'm going to get x plus x naught divided by 2 dt. And then I have the common factor e to the minus x naught squared over 4 dt. Gathering all terms, then we have minus x naught divided by 4 pi dt cubed, because the t conspires with the t over here, e to the minus x naught squared over 4 dt. So this is the flux to the origin. This I can also think of as the first passage probability. First passage probability to the origin. That is, it's the probability that a random walker or a diffusing particle comes to the origin for the very first time at time t. And now come two fundamental consequences of this simple expression, which is we can first of all compute what I'll call j, which is the integral from 0 to infinity, or capital J, the integral of little j dt. So this is the probability that I come to the origin at any time. And I'll leave this as an exercise for the student. When you compute this integration, it's exactly equal to 1. So we are sure that we will hit the origin. And similarly, the mean time to hit the origin, which is nothing more than the integral from 0 to infinity, t, j of t dt, divided by the integral from 0 to infinity of j of t dt. The denominator we all were already found was 1. But for the numerator, we have t j of t dt. But notice that the t conspires with the t to the minus 3 halves here to give something which is decaying as t to the minus 1 half. And the long time limit, the integral of t to the minus 1 half dt, is infinite. So this is equal to infinity. So we have our fundamental basic result, the first passage processes, which is that this one says that return is certain. But this one says that the return time, even though return is certain, the return time equals infinity.